on some serious shit. Deadly habits. You know everybody's got them. Just that some niggas try to front, try to cover shit up. But fuck that, I be wildin' sometimes, you know why? Cause suckers be thinking that shit is sweet. Niggas be thinking that rap niggas ain't real. Yeah, well, that's alright, that's alright. Let them think what they want.
Yo, I'm steady at it, them deadly habits. I pray for the best outcome, some, but my dome's already shattered by the shit that's occurred. Driving home tipsy from the club, puffing herb, vision blurred. Thinking about them niggas who caught the drop, who I gotta stop, who we caught, and who still gotta get popped. Stash box, feeling like fishing king in New York. Wifey do her thing for the guard, she don't be bringing me pork. Cause there's enough deadly shit a brother be facing. Up in VIP, niggas drinks they be lacing. Got a nigga sweating, pacing, not ready to fall the fuck out, but ready to pull out and back them all the fuck out. And my guardian angel is always there to protect, and my supreme nature keeps all them savages in check. How the hell did everything get so twisted? They say be careful what you pray for, so I guess now it's this shit.
They will never know
what I do to get by, and the many times I almost died.
They will never know
all the reasons why I flip, and now I gotta keep an extra clip.
They will never know
what this stress is like, and why I'm on point, ready to fight.
They will never know
all the pressure and pain. Don't give a fuck if they think less of me, man. Deadly habits, they could be a number of things. Everybody got them. Some people do ugly things. Excessive behavior, it can get the best of you. Trust me, I'm a lot like the rest of you. I got issues that haven't been resolved. You know, like money people owe me while they out having a ball. Guess they too got deadly habits. Got me on a mission to go and murk each and every faggot. Managers coked up, A&R's all doped up. Old school style, have them gagged up and roped up. Those deadly habits have me losing my cool. But yo, the son can't chill, so I'ma be abusing them fools. Pull the plug on them, pull the rug on them. Have them calling up all their closest thug friends. Them niggas can get it too. This gangstar shit is too deep to even get into. So fuck you.
They will never know
what I do to get by, and the many times I almost died.
They will never know
all the reasons why I flip, and now I gotta keep an extra clip.
They will never know
what this stress is like, and why I'm on point, ready to fight.
They will never know
the pressure and pain. Don't give a fuck if they think less of me, man. Fuck you wanna do? We way past 7:30. Be easy, too many brothers seem to go to heaven early. It's hell in these streets, but soon I'm on a hot street. Who's in the hot seat? Who had a felony beef? Yo, I beat cases with different attorneys, and I laughed at the racist DAs who were wishing to burn me. My mom caught a heart attack around the same time Newz articles were published. Around the same time, this depressed me more, but I stayed intact. And that last corny chick I was with, she got played, in fact. I know niggas that did dumb time and dumb crimes. I fuck with real niggas and never cowards with dumb minds. This country's got us in a fix. America, your deadly habits got us all up in the mix. War without, war within, holy war, mortal sin. Tell me, huh, what's the origin?
They will never know
what I do to get by, and the many times I almost died.
They will never know
all the reasons why I flip, and now I gotta keep an extra clip.
They will never know
what this stress is like, and why I'm on point, ready to fight.
They will never know
all the pressure and pain. Don't give a fuck if they think less of me, man.
It's called Police Zone 5. Mostly poor, mostly black, and an area rarely seen by the casual outsider. An area where in the past 20 months, 21 black children have been reported missing. 19 of them have been found dead. City and police officials are stymied, and they admit they can do little to stop the killings. The problems are not made easier by the fact that many of the victims were children who spent much of their time unsupervised and on the streets.
This type of person or child would be more apt to get in a car with someone or be lured off by someone than a more timid child would. So these are the type of people we're dealing with. All of them are basically the same.
The poor neighborhoods in Atlanta have names like Mechanicsville and Reynoldstown and East Lake Meadows. The people here don't get any answers from the city. They are frightened and they are angry.
The people who know the people in the city are not being used on the task force. And until that's rectified, then they cannot possibly run the best investigation they can run. The FBI men are probably wonderful, great people, probably write their mother twice a week, but they don't know beans about Atlanta.
Why has it taken so long to bring these killings to an end? What is the effect on the city and on its people? These black children, missing and murdered, are the agony of Atlanta.
This is a CBS News special report. The Agony of Atlanta. Here is CBS News correspondent Dan Rather.
Good evening. Mass murder is not a new phenomenon. 33 young men were murdered by one man in Chicago a few years ago. 26 were killed in a Texas crime, 25 in California. New York's Son of Sam was convicted of taking 6 lives before he was caught. Where the population is in the millions, it is easy for murderers to remain anonymous and to disappear without trace. That's where Atlanta is tonight, and has been for 20 agonizing months. Atlanta is the hub of the New South. Its airport is the largest. Its skyline is broken by more new office towers every year. 20,000 conventioners fill its shiny new hotels every week. Its population booms, already approaching 2 million in the metropolitan area, 500,000 in the city itself. But these days, Atlanta is not counting its blessings. It is counting its dead children. And the count has reached 19. Sam Ford tells us how it got to that.
The funerals. For a year and a half now, they have gone on. Black Atlanta burying its murdered children one by one. 19 funerals so far. It all started here 2 years ago. On July 28th, a woman was walking along this wooded road looking for aluminum cans to turn in for money when she approached this embankment. People often dump things from passing cars here. At the bottom, she saw a body, which had also, presumably, been dumped from a car the previous night. It was 14-year-old Edward Smith. He had left home 8 days earlier to go to a skating rink. He had been shot to death. Nearby lay the body of his friend, 13-year-old Alfred Evans. He had disappeared on his way to the movies 3 days earlier. Police were unable to say how he was killed. But the double murders went largely unnoticed in the Atlanta newspapers. The city was in the grip of a crime wave that threatened to make it a murder capital. The police department was undermanned and demoralized by years of bitter struggle over its racial makeup, and the murder rate was up 60% over the year before. It was the murder of an Ohio doctor, Mark Tettleman, in town for a convention, and the killing of a white secretary on a crowded downtown sidewalk at lunchtime that caught the headlines. No one recognized a child murder problem. But in November, 2 more bodies were found. 14-year-old Milton Harvey was found on the 5th, police unable to say how he died, and 3 days later, 9-year-old Yusef Bell. He had been strangled. 1980 came and children continued to disappear and die. All were black and all were poor. Having no money, most earned it by their wits in the streets, and they made easy targets of themselves. Several disappeared from shopping centers, which they frequented in hopes of picking up some change by helping people with their bags. Not all, but most, were street kids from single-parent or broken homes. All but 2 were boys. Ages range from 7 to 16. By July 1980, with 10 children missing or murdered, anguished parents had had enough. Led by Camille Bell, a 60s black activist whose own son, Yusef, had been killed, they demanded that police mount a special investigation. And when police refused, they called a news conference to blast the Black Control Police Department as uncaring. 2 weeks later, the police set up the special task force to investigate the child homicides.
Now, we have a concern because it is unusual for us to have that large number of cases in the short period of time. So we have to operate on a working assumption that there very well may be some connections.
But a year had been lost on the investigation, and the police had developed a stigma of incompetence they have yet to live down. Atlanta is a city that has long enjoyed good race relations. City leaders, realizing the potential for racial violence growing, decided to attack the child murder problem with community spirit. Blacks and whites joined in what has become a weekly search for clues by volunteers, easing black suspicions that whites did not care because their children were not being killed.
I have a son myself, and I would hope that other people would join in to help find my son if he was missing. That's why I'm out here.
The city sent police and fire officers door to door with questionnaires in search of clues. New Jersey psychic Dorothy Allison arrived with great fanfare and at police expense, promising she would find the killer. Mayor Jackson called a news conference in the First National Bank, displaying $100,000, the reward for capturing the killer or killers. But in November, it happened to 4-year-old Aaron Jackson. To the public why he hadn't watched his son more closely more than a year after the murders began.
How in the name of heaven you're going to know where your children are at all times when you have to leave them to go to work 8 to 10 hours a day, 6 days a week? You know where your children are supposed to be at.
There was a time when I could have said, well, hey, I know the Atlanta Police Department will be able to find them. And man, we got the GBI and the FBI. We ought to be able to find anybody. But I've gotten to the place that I don't have that much confidence in them anymore.
And it has continued. They have died in many ways, shot, stabbed, bludgeoned. But most all of the recent ones have been strangled or asphyxiated. In some cases, the bodies were laid out in full view, on their backs with arms and legs extended. Others have been thrown down an embankment, into a river, under a building. There are things that suggest drugs, sexual deviation, or cult ritual. There are many theories, but nobody is in jail.
To understand the effect on this city, it is important to understand the neighborhoods where many of the victims were born and lived. That story in a moment.
Hey, what's this? No homecoming kiss? What's wrong, babe?
Jonathan, it's your breath.
My breath? That bad?
You need Clorets, the breath deodorant.
The breath deodorant? Sounds strong.
Clorets with Actizol is strong to deodorize mouth odors. It helps your mouth's own freshening power eliminate bad breath.
Terrific. Cost much?
A little more.
But for the breath deodorant, it's worth it.
Clorets, the breath deodorant.
For 30 years, I've been a hairdresser in Hollywood, where hot lights cause dull, dry hair. I never found anything better than Alberto VO5 conditioning hairdressing. Just a touch of VO5's concentrated formula before blow-drying or combing puts hair in healthy-looking condition. And VO5 keeps his hair in place, too. Give your dull, dry hair the star treatment with Alberto VO5 Conditioning Hairdressing.
Look great with Alberto Culver's Look Great Rebate and receive $3 in-store coupons good on merchandise at participating stores.
The urban sprawl that is Atlanta is spread over 5 counties. It is crisscrossed by superhighways that open up all areas of the city to quick and easy access by a commuter or by someone bent on murder. The dead children, dumped where they were found, lay scattered over a wide area, often far from their homes. Ed Bradley takes a look at Atlanta and the places where the victims lived.
Atlanta has long been a magnet for blacks. Years ago, it attracted people from rural areas throughout the South and established itself as a center for upwardly mobile blacks.
Predominantly black colleges and universities have been here for more than 100 years. Black businesses and professionals have long been part of the fabric of life in Atlanta. When the civil rights movement met overt, bitter opposition throughout most of the South, it was different here. There was opposition to change, of course, but here there were no fire hoses or attacks by police dogs. Atlanta was a city that called itself too busy to hate. And today, it's a city that is still changing, still growing. A black man is the mayor here, another heads the police, more are on the city council and the school board. Black professionals have moved into middle management positions in some of those office towers. The University Center is still growing, still turning out black college graduates. And there are new prosperous black enclaves in addition to well-kept middle-class black neighborhoods that have been part of Atlanta for years.
But you can't really see all of that from here, the Techwood Homes area. And it could also be Mechanicsville or East Lake Meadow, neighborhoods that were home to some of the murdered children. For most of them, and for most of the people who live here, downtown Atlanta is a world away. Here, there's no significant new construction, no office towers. Some neighborhoods don't even have a supermarket. Along these streets, you find vacant lots and substandard housing, poverty and apathy, and many people who see no way out. Many of the children in these neighborhoods have been called hustlers, and that shouldn't be taken in a negative sense. Only a handful of the murdered kids had what's been called minor brushes with the law. Those kids and others still alive found ways to hustle a dollar, running errands, carrying groceries, doing odd jobs. In other neighborhoods, they might be called kids with get up and go. But around here, there's no place to go for most. These poverty-lined streets are like barriers to that downtown world and the rest of Atlanta. The apathy, parental neglect, poor education, and social burden they house produce a life that is difficult for most of us to imagine. And on top of all of that, each day, they still have to live these streets. Each day, they still have to survive and wonder who will be next.
That question, who will be next, has changed the way of life for countless Atlanta children. Each one now has to live with the frightening knowledge that he or she could be the answer. There are still kids, mind you, who carry on in the old ways. Too many of them. Sam Ford paid a visit to one who no longer does.
He's 12 years old and lives with his 26-year-old mother, a single parent on welfare. His name is Tony. He has two little sisters. One's name is Janice, even though her shirt says Christy. Like many of the boys who died, Tony used to go to the shopping centers and carry groceries for people for tips. It was good money.
Last time I came home with $20.
Yeah, that's pretty good, isn't it?
The other boy came home with $23.
But that's all in the past. As Tony says, they're snatching too many children now, including some of his friends.
When he seen it on television, he said, I know that little boy. I said, yeah. So we used to go to school together. I said, yeah. And he used to tell me they go through the pass together and kill the snake together. You know, they was friends.
Tony practices his basketball shots with a garbage can. He doesn't have a basketball goal at home, and it's too dangerous to go to the public courts anymore. He has lost a great deal of his freedom, and like many Atlanta children, is wondering, why us?
I don't know why they pick it now. They should pick another country or city.
Throughout Atlanta, there have been reports of children so terrified they have begun wetting the bed again or are afraid to sleep by themselves. Some middle-class black parents have sent their children to relatives in other cities, even though no middle-class kids have been murdered. But Tony's mother knows that her son's survival may depend on whether he remembers her rule. When on the way home from school, don't stop for anybody.
I be scared every day when he go to school. And I tell him each and every day the same thing over and over and over, but he listened to me. And I just hope they don't get Tony.
Do you worry about that sometime?
Sometime.
But you're determined that they won't, right?
No, maybe will, maybe not.
The police investigation so far has been unsuccessful and riddled with problems. Some are external, the kind that are normal when there is trouble in a poor black southern community. Some are internal. They exist inside the several police departments involved and, say, the parents of the victims. They are the problems that keep the murderer or murderers from being caught. That part of the story after this pause.
Don't worry, kid. I'll give you half a potato chip.
I don't want those flat chips. I'd rather have nothing.
Oh, would you be wanting some of me Ruffles potato chips?
Ruffles? Oh, boy, my favorite.
For a lot of people, it's Ruffles brand potato chips or nothing, because Ruffles taste better than regularly made flat chips.
He sure likes these Ruffles. It's the third time this week he's been lost.
For a lot of people, it's Ruffles or nothing.
Colombia, every night new coffee beans ripen. And for Juan Valdez, every day is a day of harvest. A day to pick by hand only those coffee beans which have become ready. At the end of each day, Juan leaves the fields and prepares to harvest again. For in Colombia, they know that the richest coffee in the world never rests.
You know, hon, Sue's table looks something like ours.
Frank, it's exactly like ours.
Oh, no, it isn't. It's prettier.
Sue, what's your secret?
All I do is dust with pledge.
Could pledge make a difference?
Mm-hmm.
Let's see if Sue is right.
Look, pledge shines better than our old polish.
My side looks blurry, but pledge is beautiful.
Ever notice that Sue's table looks just like
ours?
Yeah.
Let pledge bring out the beauty every time you dust.
Honey, our itch and rash problems are solved. I got something for the itching of winter dry skin, jewelry rash, detergent hands, dermatitis, eczema.
Whoa. I have relief for itching dry skin, jewelry rash, detergent hands, Cordaid. Cordaid has one of the most effective ingredients for minor itches and rashes you can buy without a prescription.
Our problems are solved, except one.
What?
What do we do with these?
Cordaid, all you need for the temporary relief of minor itches and rashes.
Yeah.
Atlanta's reputation as a city of progress pours in conventions and business meetings worth $400 million a year. And so, after that June weekend mentioned earlier, when Dr. Mark Tuttleman was killed, the city, to protect its reputation and business, launched a massive campaign for street safety. Part of that effort was the construction of these police boxes. They were to be manned 24 hours a day, or at least during statistically determined high crime hours. The idea was to keep maximum visible police presence on the streets. What distressed the people of Zone 5, and especially parents of the missing children, was that the street safety program was aimed at the area of the Conventioneer, the already relatively safe, certainly prosperous, downtown area. To blacks in Zone 5, the boxes became yet another sign that the city cared more about business than it did about child killers. What may also have angered people was that the boxes did not then, nor do they now, have much effect on anything. Because, as you can see, these police boxes are unmanned and locked. Just another empty effort, as the people in Zone 5 see it, like so many others made by the city and the Atlanta Police Department. Is that criticism valid? Bruce Hall examines that question.
After months of work, an investigator says the special task force has made virtually no progress. They do not even know if the killer is black or white, male or female, acting alone or part of a group. Not only do they know little about the killer or killers, some of the 39 police agencies in the 5-county metropolitan area are feuding bitterly among themselves and withholding information when it is developed. Sources say the special task force has been hurt by petty jealousies, poor communications, and inexperienced investigators who have mishandled critical evidence. The infighting became so fierce, Atlanta Public Safety Director Lee Brown was forced to call at least two closed-door summit meetings with agency heads after investigators said they were stumbling all over each other. However, the friction continues. W.K. Perry, former chief of the Atlanta Homicide Department and now head of a group of officers investigating the case, says the task force bungled it.
Yes, we furnished them with numerous leads. From our sources, we would check back in a couple of weeks and find that some of these leads were not pursued by the task force.
The police on the beat don't know enough about what even what cars they're looking for. They could pass through all day long and they'd never see them.
The officials are not telling them enough about...
Oh, heavens no. The best kept secret in the world in Atlanta is what is the task force doing.
We obviously do many things which we can't talk about because it would be counterproductive. We made a policy decision some time ago that there's information about what we know, there are activities we are engaged in, that if we talked about it, it would be counterproductive.
However, a highly placed source who is knowledgeable about the investigation says nothing is being released because they still have no information on the identity of the killer. And some of the investigative techniques are controversial, like the use of children as decoys. Officers watch from nearby unmarked vehicles as decoys, youngsters ranging from 12 to 16 years old, are sent to shopping centers, where it is believed that the killer has been picking up kids. Another thing that is causing controversy among policemen, some officers have been told to watch each other because there is a suspicion that the killer may be a policeman or former officer. Roadblocks are becoming frequent occurrences in black neighborhoods. Officials hope they will discourage the killer from roaming through the areas. What is not generally known is that key suspects have been developed in at least 4 and possibly 6 cases, but most of these are family related, and officers do not believe they are connected with the main group of murders. Officials say no indictments are being sought against these suspects now, because that could take away from the overall investigation. The state crime lab found identical cloth fibers on or near 6 of the bodies, thus providing the first solid evidence some of the cases are linked. But while the cases may be linked, the investigative agencies involved freely admit they have no suspects, and it may take more than hard work to solve the case.
We're going to have to be a little lucky as we go along with this. We are doing hard work. We're trying to make our breaks, but certainly we need a break and need a little luck.
In an attempt to find out how difficult it would be to abduct a black youngster from the neighborhoods where the murders have taken place, plainclothes policemen in unmarked cars were sent into the areas. When they saw a youngster, the officer would yell, "Want to make $10?" The police were shocked with the results. Every youngster approached got into the car.
So there has been plenty of criticism for Atlanta police, but the circle of criticism also includes community leadership as well as law enforcement. Pam Olson tells us about that.
There are billboards reminding people they can be paid for information leading to the capture of the killer or killers. Despite the reward, there has been little response.
They're saying to me, we need money to run an investigation. I basically wonder whether some of the money that's being used to keep the image of the city from being tarnished couldn't be used to run an investigation.
There are other problems. Criticism is beginning to come from inside the black community. Criticism of the city's black leadership.
People talk about people profiteering off of the tragedy. But I see political careers being built and broken on the coffins of these children.
And there is more. Atlanta youth worker Corrine Brown believes the more prosperous, more prominent blacks in Atlanta could have done more.
I haven't heard from our black leaders. I have not. They've been mighty silent during this whole thing. We've got something here now that has been running over a year.
Until recently, and some say because of the pressure, the more nationally known black leaders of Atlanta have been silent. It has taken Coretta King 19 months to speak out locally on the killings. Last week, at a press conference, she announced a march and demonstration. She did not appear at this rather small street event last weekend. Then Andy Young. 19 months after the first bodies were found, he came to the defense of the city's black establishment.
Everybody's working together to try to put an end to these crimes. I do think, though, that you really won't catch the killer by putting the police on trial.
More and more people across the country have jumped on the bandwagon. Baltimore, a memorial mass raised money for the investigation. North Carolina, floral wreaths honor the memories of the children. Missouri, university students raised money for the victims' families. Tennessee, 2,000 attended a rally. Pennsylvania, a grandmother started passing out green ribbons. And in Rhode Island, a basketball team wears them. Here in Atlanta, vigilante groups scout popular places looking for violators of the city's new curfew. Fraternities distribute blue ribbons. Though the support is late in coming, it is nonetheless sincere. But it is, in the words of Camille Bell, too little, too late.
The people of Atlanta, both black and white, are being forced to recognize some very unpleasant things about their community and about themselves. More on that in a moment.
Hi, I'm Keenan Wynn. Competition riding has been a loud part of my life. Now, unfortunately, I didn't wear hearing protectors and I suffered a hearing loss. Noise is the leading cause of hearing loss. The danger is even greater for people who work at noisy jobs without hearing protection. Many of them, like me, are among the more than 16 million Americans with a hearing problem. I got help. For me, it was hearing aids. Virtually everyone now could be helped, medically, surgically, with hearing aids, or through rehabilitation. If you or someone you know doesn't hear well, get a hearing checkup. Save your hearing. Wear protection. For free information, write hearing, Box 1840, Washington, D.C., 213.
Hey, Dad!
You should hear what you're missing.
The long, wrenching experience of Atlanta's child killings is forcing back into the open long-festering problems many people didn't want to face. John Sheehan looks at the possible consequences.
Okay, let me just throw out something at you for you to think about for a minute. That, remember that it's black kids like you, the one that's being killed.
Black children in Atlanta get classes in how to avoid being murdered. But no one, not even their parents, can teach them how to deal with fear.
You know, they don't know who to trust, you know, so they say things like, you know, well, daddy, where do we go? You know, I said, well, like, you know, if it's near a store, just run in the store, you know. No policemen, nobody, you know, don't go to nobody, just run, you know. And not walk too close to the courage, man, because, you know, I don't know what to say to them, really, you know, I'm just frightened myself.
I always carry a knife in my pocketbook all the time. Like, when I finna get ready to walk on my way home, I put it up my sleeve, just in case.
Sociologist Craig Beverly sees black Atlantans being crippled by fear.
I don't think we have even begun to see. We have seen only the surface part of the effects of the situation on not only just children, but, you know, adults also. And then you're going to have a lot of people who are going to need people to talk to, places to go, to just kind of work through their own sense of frustrations, their own sense of impotency.
Whites have joined the weekly search parties looking for clues and contributed money for a reward. But while whites have responded sympathetically to a local Atlanta problem, Atlanta blacks are feeling more isolated, feeling overwhelmed by a nationwide lack of concern about blacks. The murders have reopened many wounds.
These victims are the dead children, but millions of blacks, young blacks who are not missing, who have not been murdered, are being slaughtered psychologically, emotionally, educationally, and there seems to be no intense concern for them.
And in the wake of the killings, the community is hearing about things children do not tell their parents, that being approached by strangers and getting into a car is a common event in the lives of poor black children. Sometimes it's the way to the day's meal or a little money. Columbus Ward, himself a former street kid, now director of a youth center, knows only too well about the grown-ups who prey upon desperately poor children.
They seem to come into the low-income area where they know that there are a lot of street kids. They know that kids is in need of a lot of service and help. If in a way they think they can provide some of those needs to those kids for their own benefit, then they will approach a kid for that service, you know, for sex, for favors or whatever. I think that that they will you know, concentrate on the low-income area because their chance of convincing a kid to get in the car with them is very good.
Blacks are coming to perceive the vulnerability of their children as being a direct result of deplorable inner-city living conditions. Nearly one out of five black men out of work. Men of broken spirit who leave the families they cannot support. Mothers who have to become the breadwinner in the debasing atmosphere of the public housing projects.
Almost any housing project in American society could be converted into a maximum security prison in 5 minutes. Public housing is a reaffirmation every day for folk who live there that they are defined by American society being less than human.
For a moment, Atlanta's missing and murdered children united the black and white communities in sorrow. But it seems they have already begun to separate again.
The tragedy is that I feel that when and if the murderers are caught, or the murderer is caught, that the status quo will be maintained.
The mayor of Atlanta, Maynard Jackson, has served two terms as mayor, one term as vice mayor, total of 12 years in the leadership of the city. Mayor, a number of people have said to me, one of them quite eloquently, that the concern in the black community is that once the murderer or murderers are caught, that things in Atlanta will return to the status quo. What's your reaction to that?
It's possible, but not likely. Possible because we have seen precedent. The riots in the 60s, everybody responded, coming forward. What can we do? What more can we do now? We don't want the riots. We now see we've been making a mistake. Society has been inadequately responsive. Riots died down. The response died down, and the concern apparently died down too. That could happen here, but it's not going to happen here. We'll never be the same city again. We'll be a stronger city because of this awful tragedy, because of the lesson we'll learn from it. We have seen an underside of Atlanta that is a part of the underside of America. More tightly focused than ever before, of kids who have to hustle in the streets, not beg, but hustle for jobs, the great American dream, to make it, and families that are so desperately poor, so much involved, so working, they're not able sometimes to be as attentive to each other as they might want to be.
What about the criticism that the city and the police department have not done enough, particularly that they didn't do enough soon enough?
We have made a policy decision, though, Mr. Rather. We decided that we were going to run the risk of some criticism rather than compromise the investigation. We are doing 1,000 times more than we are willing to say, 1,000 times more than we're prepared to say, and we would rather run the risk of the criticism than to leak something or have something come out which might assist the killer or killers and might harm the case. We are hoping that all will follow that guideline.
Thank you, Mayor. It is standard practice in this kind of broadcast to try and write a thoughtful close, to make an effort at summation or special perspective. But in this case, this time, in the agony of Atlanta, it is our feeling that any effort at summation should be made by people who have lived with the story for a long time. For that reason, we close with final thoughts by Dr. Charles King and Mayor Jackson.
We hand our children to a society without the proper kind of undergirding, economically or educational, that would give them a chance in life. This, my friend, is murder before they die. We slay them before they have a chance. And if you really want to know who the real killers are, it's not just the one or two people that we're searching for. The real killers are the whites who condone it, black politicians who don't give a damn anymore about what happens to black people because they're fighting each other to gain office. And even if they wanted to do something about it, and even if they are still sensitive to the problems of black people, they are powerless to change the situations that white institutions initially set into motion that created ghetto conditions. It's almost like cast in concrete. So if you really want to know who the real killers are, it's not just the one or two people we're talking about. The real killers are us.
That as Boston had it, Buffalo, Houston, Chicago, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and many others, and now Atlanta, it could happen anywhere. And we pray to God it never will. We're praying it will happen here, never again.
From Atlanta, Dan Rather, CBS News. Good night.
When you want someone to think you're tops, try a bunch of Tootsie Pops. Give your Tootsie a Tootsie. If a happy family is your goal, surprise them with a Tootsie Roll. Give your Tootsie a Tootsie. If you want to get someone's attention every time you stop, we've got the greatest invention. It's called a Tootsie Pop Drop. When you want to brighten someone's day, Tootsie's got a lot of ways. Give your Tootsie a Tootsie. Give your Tootsie a Tootsie.
Hold it! The fan's blowing too hard.
Okay. Don't be so impatient.
I know I shouldn't be, but my doctor says too much caffeine makes me tense.
You should drink Sanka brand decaffeinated coffee.
I like real coffee.
Sanka brand's 100% real coffee. Try it.
Mmm. Delicious.
Jane, you did it again.
And I feel like myself again with Sanka brand.
Sanka brand. Enjoy your coffee and enjoy yourself.
This is CBS.
Chimere, an extraordinary fragrance. To the world, it's discreet, but up close, it's something else. To the world, it's elegant, but up close, it's something else. Chimere, a unique kind of fragrance that captures both sides of a woman. To the world, it's discreet and elegant, but it's something else up close. Chimere.
This is it, ShopRite's 30th anniversary sale, and the savings are everywhere. Ocean Spray joins in the celebration with special savings on Ocean Spray Grapefruit Juice for 99 cents and Ocean Spray Cran Apple or Cran Grape Drink $1.19. Enjoy Ocean Spray quality at ShopRite prices. ShopRite's 30th anniversary sale is on now. Celebrate the prices plus the variety and quality at ShopRite.
Manhattan is...
In our family, we all know who's boss, right, Lana?
You spent the afternoon down at Charlie's bar.
Go on, tell her off!
Well, we're moving on.